This is a question for Tami. I'm really interested in kind of your research. I had a question, though, just about this idea of transparency, because as you were going through it, I was thinking, is this transparency or is this social interaction, right? So transparency to me would be if I could just see my hamburger being made asynchronous, then that should improve how much I like to taste, because I just saw it. It wasn't, yep. But this was, hey, what's going on? Hey, what's going on? You know, that does that have something to do with it? So did you do any kind of one-sided views of this to see if that effect still holds?
That's exactly what we did. We were able to use the iPads to have it one-sided transparency, so customers seeing employees at work, but employees not being able to, and vice versa, and then also turn both of them on so they can see one another. To your question about whether it's transparency or social interaction, so I should also note that during this time, there was no verbal interaction. It was just visual. And I would like to answer to your question saying that it's creating, it's turning financial transaction into social interaction via this visual transparency. And those two are not necessarily separate things, but that they're very powerful. They can be very powerful combined together.
Okay, let's get the mics going around. So go ahead, Ben, and then we'll come over here, David.
So I think I know the answer to this, but Lily had a question around bias. Did men and women show any systematic differences in the ratings?
Nope.
Exactly.
Okay. No, so actually that was one of the questions that we were, of course, interested in, because the first argument that anyone makes is, oh, this men must show this bias more than women. But I think we see in a lot of the bias and gender research that stereotypes are held by both men and women, and they're so deeply ingrained that we show them subconsciously through actions that we take every day. And I guess it's disappointing in one sense, but you know, we find that consistently. There's no difference in men and women's behavior towards other people.
I think that was David's question, so we'll come right over here.
So in the analysis, and this is for Lily also, when it came back, it looks like there was a rating and comment on the applications. So they rated the application, and there was some commentary that they gave them back around whether they thought the application was good or not. It looked like there were both.
So actually, what this research is differentiates from other research is that we use quantitative scales for the most part because we really wanted to sort of hone in on specific differences. So there's no way to just manipulate language in this study, although we did do another study where we have people give qualitative feedback as well to people. And we do find that people use more emotion-type words when giving feedback to women and do tend to sugarcoat it a little bit. But I think what's interesting about this research is that it really shows these, you know, a 15% difference is pretty big. It's taking it over the 50% mark. So, yeah, that was really interesting.
That was it. I just wondered if the difference between the qualitative and quantitative were the same. Like, was there rate the 15% higher, but what you would write may look different, but it sounds like they match also.
Well, I mean, the qualitative is a lot more complex. So you're getting, you know, there's been different kinds of research looking at, well, women are criticized on one thing, but then they're elevated in another thing. So you're having a lot of complexity there. But we use qualitative. We gave them choices, for example, between a nice passage or a less nice passage. So we're actually giving them the qualitative stuff that it was highly controlled. And people picked the nicer passages to give to women rather than the harsher but more accurate ones. So we do still find the exact same difference for that.
Let's get Lori and then Mickey. Okay.
Lily, of course, you know, I think your work is fascinating. In case people are wondering in the audience if it has to do with stereotyping women as nicer, so there's some kind of social mimicry going on, she knows. I'm sure that Kent Harbor shows a very similar effect with African-American feedback from whites given to African-Americans. Yeah. So I'm wondering to what extent is it a bend over backwards not to appear to be sexist, which also can be done unconsciously, right? People
right.
can be unconscious egalitarians, if you will. So trying to overcompensate in that sense.
Yeah. It's interesting because there's different theories that could lead to this question. And one of the ones we've been exploring is whether there's a type of affirmative action type thinking that's happening with, I'm going to support her, and then she's going to do better because I've elevated her confidence. So again, you know, this is all, I think this is really stemming from a good place, which is why, you know, I think why I called you out and asked you if you were felt nice, that we do these things sometimes trying to be good people, but have to be aware of the differences in the way that we're interacting with people. So yeah, I think it actually could happen with other types of groups of people that elicit the same type of reactions.
Okay, while we get the mic back to Mickey, I wanted to ask Christine, so one of the things I really liked about your research is that it's not that we think other people think the same way we do, we actually think they think the opposite way we do. And I was wondering if you know of any other research, I think I've read some about how people value money.
Yeah, Chip Heath has some really great work out of Stanford a long time ago at this point, but if you ask people whether they're motivated by intrinsic rewards or extrinsic rewards, so how much you feel like you have a sense of purpose from your job versus how much you want to raise, they really care about intrinsic things, but if you ask them to predict what other people care about, they care about money and having more time off. So there's a whole host of social biases that we seem to have between self and other that play out in lots of interesting ways.
All right, let's get Mickey's question.
On?
Yes.
Okay. First of all, good job to all of you students. That's impressive. Yay. The second thing is I have a question for you, Lily, as well. Two things that I was thinking might be next steps, maybe. One is, do the women believe the feedback? So I ask my husband, does my butt look big in this? And he says, no. And I go, are you sure? Because I know he's going to say that to everything. So that's the first thing is, do the women know that they're not getting accurate feedback, and do they believe it? As we know, the literature on physical disability shows they're not getting good feedback, and they know it. Okay, so that's my first question. The second thing is that if they did poorly on the essay, then you might see a releasing mechanism where they're particularly likely to be more negative toward women. So, you know what, if it's okay, I'm gonna give you the benefit of the doubt, but if you did a crappy job, that may really evoke and make the sort of expression of prejudice come out. Any thoughts on that?
Yes, in fact, I have a study on that. So I'm gonna answer your second question first. What was particularly interesting for me out of this research is that the first study that we did when we pre-tested these essays, we gave people a bunch of bad essays, and we said, you know, we basically told them the genders and said, how bad are these essays? The ones that we had identified as female written got way lower marks, because I think that there's this idea that women are good writers, and so they're punished when they're doing worse on a task that they're supposed to be good at. And so if anything, in this study, we should see the opposite, in this study, people were actually telling women that they're doing better, and even though they were probably evaluating them after the fact as, oh, well, that must have been really bad since she wrote it. So yeah, I think that there definitely is this shifting standards, as Monica Biernat would put it. And then your first question was about detecting lies, and I want to say there's research been done on this. I don't know, Lori, if you remember who did this. But I think there's some research on disadvantaged groups being able to detect different treatment towards them, as you mentioned. And I have to say, this research was sort of born out of myself detecting this from supervisors, saying, oh, I wonder if I'm getting accurate feedback compared to my peers. So really, I mean, I'm not trying to throw my supervisors under the bus, but it just sparked a question for me. And so I would love to test that in a more controlled way. So thanks for that.
Okay, we've got one question, last question, there we go.
Yeah, I'm wondering whether there's a way to draw a thread among all three pieces of research. Also, I've resisted saying good job because I didn't want you to think it was inauthentic.
This is the curse.
But I wonder whether there's a way to draw a thread among all three pieces of research. And it really, Christine's work really goes to the heart of it. It seems like that in all cases, we're making assumptions about other people that we don't make about ourselves. And if you can say, so we think that other people care about their bodies, not their minds. In breaking down the transparency, we realize, hey, the guy making the food, he's kind of like me. The guy eating the food, he's kind of like me. And in the case of the essays, we know from Lily's research that people actually want that authentic feedback. So I wonder, is there a way to sort of change that default? That when we make these decisions, our default assumption is that other person is actually more like me than different from me. So is there any research on that default assumption? And is there a way to actually flip that among people if that ends up being a good idea?
there's some interesting work on the fact that people engage in two really sort of wrong choices. They over-attribute similarity or they under-attribute it, and they never really seem to hit the sweet spot. So if I'm reminded that we're similar, now I think we're the same person. I can't get people to do it for my study. I would love to figure out how, but people seem to vacillate and they don't converge in the right spot very often. So I think what's important is to remind people that, like, Tami has a brain and I can ask her what she thinks. I don't have to just sit here and be like, oh, well, I know. So I think that there is definitely a common thread between all of these, and it can present problems that are simply fixed by asking people what they care about.
Okay. And in addition, there's several low-cost tactics that organizations can use. So for example, in my findings, seeing was very powerful, and that was a very powerful way to reduce social distance, not just between managers and employees, but also between employees and customers.
So. Great. Well, in a moment, I'll ask you to help me thank our speakers. But with this, I encourage you all to go to the break. We will come back promptly at 3:15. Go find the nuggets of insight and wisdom that reside in this room. And thank you to our speakers.